Good evening from the Gail Lemron Auditorium and the Captain Willie Miller Building in the campus of Embry-Riddle. My name is Mark Bernier. Welcome to the Embry-Riddle Speaker Series. Tonight, in our final installment for the fall, Where We Live, the History of Florida and Daytona Beach. Two dynamic authors and historians join us. One we know from the community, the other we know from the region. It is my great pleasure to introduce the two to you now. We'll have a discussion about Florida and Daytona Beach. From the University of Central Florida, historian and author, Dr. James Clark. As well as your friend from the News Journal, longtime columnist, reporter, author, Mark Lane. Gentlemen, welcome to Embry-Riddle. Thank you for being with us. Where do we begin? Who discovered Florida, Dr. Clark?
Probably the Indians. Probably about 10, 12,000 years ago. Remember, the Indians migrate down from Asia, so we're kind of the last stop for them. They populate the rest of what's now the United States, even go down into Mexico and Central America, and then finally get here.
I was at the Miami Book Fair the other day, and we were talking about how Cuba came to be what it was. I think we're getting a little bit of echo bounce back. Thank you. And Cuba was thought to be, I guess, India, that Columbus, right, when he came. So who of the explorers first settles or stumbles upon Florida and says, wow, this isn't China?
Well, you know, there are a number of theories here. First of all, I have the Jim Clark theory, which is you can tell where explorers have been by the reception they get from the Indians. And this is true. Ponce de Leon comes to eastern Florida, there are no problems. When he comes back later to Charlotte Harbor in southwest Florida, he's greeted by Indians who kill him. So it tells us that they had experienced the Spanish before, didn't like them. And so Ponce de Leon, obviously, Hernando de Soto. If you want to know what kind of a state you live in, there are 67 counties in Florida, and they couldn't think of county names. I mean, that would seem pretty simple, don't you think? Naming counties. So we have two counties named after the same person.
Okay.
Hernando and de Soto.
Wow.
Yeah. You'd think they could have come up with somebody.
And they pass Florida around like an old penny. It goes from the British to the French to the Spanish. And I don't know if it comes back to any of them before the U.S. gets involved.
The Spanish and the French battle it out. Mm-hmm. And Spanish win that one. I always thought, I don't know if anybody has been up to Matanzas Inlet. Isn't that a pretty name, Matanzas Inlet?
And a high school named Matanzas.
Yeah.
For the massacres.
Yeah, and in Spanish it means place of slaughter. Mm-hmm.
So they name a high school after a place of slaughter.
Slaughter, yeah.
It's motivating for the football team.
Yeah, they... I'm not sure how religious I am, but the Spanish gave the French a choice. They could convert to Catholicism or have their heads cut off. And they picked Protestantism. I think I would have converted in about a minute. So they were slaughtered there on the beach. If you ever get a chance to go up to St. Augustine, may I recommend Fort Matanzas National Park. Have you been there? I like the little fort there better than the big fort. The big fort's this huge tourist attraction. The little fort you get by a little boat, it's free, it's a national park. And the little fort there, you go up in it, it's really neat.
Yeah, it's a lovely view.
Jim Purdy, the public defender, would probably have something to say about that, as he shoots a cannon every weekend from the Big Fort, I think, doesn't he, Mark?
Yeah, he's the cannon guy. He's one of the cannon guys. Yeah, that's his hobby.
And there's a lot to cover in several hundred years, but we get to a point where the United States ends at, what, the Georgia line? that's about?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Right. And so what I was told last weekend was that the French, I'm trying to remember if the French had Florida at that time, it was probably the Spanish, but they need cash, and we buy Florida? Is that what happens?
Florida had spiraled out of control. The British had it, and can I give your audience here a quick test?
Absolutely.
Mm. All right. How many original colonies were there?
13. How many?
15. People don't realize there were 15 original colonies because they're ashamed of East and West Florida, which, as Mark knows, remained loyal to the king. We were a Tory colony. They used it for staging areas for British troops and British loyalists escaping from Georgia and the Carolinas came into Florida to seek protection. So we were strongly pro-British in Florida. And then we made a mistake in giving up the British rule. When you think about it, King George wanted what? A tax on wool? Gee, that would be a real burden here in Florida, all your wool suits. Those three-pointed hats, I'm sure a lot of you have three-pointed hats at home. And finally, tea, the big tea party. Nothing like a cup of hot tea in unair-conditioned Florida in 1776. So instead of the tax on wool clothing, three-pointed hats, and hot tea, we went with the sales tax, the property tax, the income tax, the excise tax, and the rest. So if we had stayed with Britain, we'd be kind of like Bermuda today. You know? Nobody ever complains about Bermuda, Mark.
So we buy it, what, 1813, it becomes a state around
1821, we buy it, $5 million, which really goes for claims.
And not a lot of people living here, and half of the people were slaves?
Half the people were slaves, yeah.
Wow. So this advances, and I didn't know until I read your book, and I read it this morning, that Florida was probably really going to be East Florida, West Florida, not North and South, as many of us would think. And two capitals, right?
Two capitals originally, Pensacola and St. Augustine.
St. Augustine, and that's how Tallahassee got to be centrally located away from everything, is that it was like the halfway point between Pensacola, St. Augustine. It was a compromise.
So Miami and all the stuff south, nobody was paying attention.
Nothing south of Tampa, yeah.
The people of the north had a real snobby opinion of Florida. They were like, low-life people live there, it's all swamp, it's nothing. You know, it's like a burden. And so when the Civil War comes, before the Civil War comes, you write that, and I'm doing this because I want to get to the contemporary stuff as well. If I'm not mistaken, Iowa is going to come in to the Union at the time Florida is. Isn't that right?
That's right. They were matching slave and free states. And we said, hey, we want to come in as two states. Congress said, hey, we got Iowa ready to come in. No telling when there'll be a second state, kind of now or never. And so we went with one state in 1845.
This is such a great book. Where do you think the first shots of the Civil War were actually fired? Anybody? Where? Fort Sumter. See, that's what I thought. But in fact, it's?
Pensacola, Lincoln. In fact, thought the war would start in Pensacola, as did everybody else. And instead, it goes to Fort Sumter, but shots were fired in Pensacola, and the forts are still there. I don't know if anybody's ever been to the forts in Pensacola.
Fort Pickens?
Yeah, and seen the forts there. But we thought it was going to, Lincoln thought it was going to start here.
Was there any kind of territorial battle at the panhandle? In other words, Alabama, Mississippi thought they'd take pieces of Florida, because it comes up to that panhandle, it's like lower Alabama. Was there ever any talk that it might become part of their state and not Florida?
They did. You know, people forget when Hernando de Soto claimed Florida, it's original Florida stretched up to present-day Washington, D.C., and over to the Mississippi. And since then, everybody kept gobbling us up. Parts of Louisiana, parts of Alabama, parts of Mississippi, and parts of Georgia all came out of Florida. As late as 1810, Baton Rouge was a Florida city. People don't realize that. So everybody kind of stole things from us. And in fact, Texas stole our flag.
Oh, really?
We originally had the Lone Star flag. And so everybody kind of opened season on Florida.
I got to back up because the Trail of Tears, where Indians are marched out, did it start here and goes to Oklahoma?
Yeah, here in Georgia and goes to Oklahoma.
Was it the Cherokee or the Seminole? They march them off.
Both, actually. The Seminoles from Florida. What's strange is that they probably got, what would say, Mark, 90-95% of them out of Florida. And the ones that remained went into the Everglades and hid out. And today, those are the people who own the Hard Rock Cafe and are billionaires.
Andrew Jackson is what Jacksonville is named after. Is that correct?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
What happens with Andrew Jackson in Florida? Because he doesn't make a lot of friends down here.
No, he didn't like us either. That's our first territorial governor. For a very short time. But he invaded the place too. Yeah.
He invaded the place?
He only came here to hang people.
Yeah.
And he hated Florida. That's the weird thing. We have Jacksonville named after him. We have a county in the panhandle named after him. And he hated Florida. He only took the territorial governor job because he thought he'd be able to appoint all the officials in the territory and give his old army buddies jobs. When the president said, "Nah, you're not doing that," he quit after just a few months and left. The president wrote him back and said, "Hey, could you stick around for just a little bit longer until I can name somebody else?" And by the time the letter got here, he had already left.
Yeah.
So he's not a friend of Florida.
Leaping into the Civil War, does Florida come in as a willing partner? Or it's like, you know, we're territorially landlocked here. I guess we got to fight with these people. Did they want to be part of it?
I think so. They've got to remember the political power was all in North Florida then, and this was in kind of middle North Florida was Cotton Belt still, and they were all for it. There were some old Jacksonians who warned that they were getting into more than they thought. And going at FSU, going down Call Street, old Governor Call was considered kind of senile because he was warning people that they were going to regret this decision for the rest of their lives. Unionists were a small voice, but there were small pockets like Key West never left the Union, you know.
Really?
Yeah.
And Jacksonville came and went.
Depending on who was in town.
Right, yeah. It really wasn't a target. Florida, Tallahassee remains the only capital east of the Mississippi not taken during the war, and that's no distinction. It's just nobody wanted it. It had no military value. The only attempt, the only battle fought in Florida was the Battle of Alusty. It's also the only battle that President Lincoln organized through a weird, crazy scheme that he came up with in 1864. He was worried about his reelection. He thought if he could get Florida back in the Union, it would vote Republican because he wouldn't let the Confederates vote, and it would give him 3 electoral votes. So this Battle of Alusty was fought, perhaps because Lincoln organized it. It was a military disaster.
The Union Army kind of got lost.
Yeah. Yeah. It's called the Battle of Alusty. The Union did not intend to fight there. They just, as Mark says, got lost. The Confederates were waiting.
So the war comes to an end, and then you have Reconstruction, of course. Do all the states come in at the same time? Is Florida one of the first, or do they wait for a deal? How do they come back into the Union?
I think we were one of the earlier ones. I'd have to look that up, actually. But, you know, our Confederate governor hurried things along by shooting himself in the head as soon as the war was lost, rather than live under Yankee rule. And
doesn't Jefferson Davis make his way down here?
He does. Yeah, he's heading for Madison. Mm-hmm. By the way, speaking of names, Madison County, mm-hmm. the county seat is named Madison, which is not that unusual. What is unusual in the country is that it's the only place where the county and the county seat have the same name, Madison, and they're named for different people. I can't figure that out. But one of them's for President Madison. But he's coming into Florida. He's going to make his escape. Two of his cabinet members escaped through Florida. One comes down the St. John's, the former Vice President of the United States, John Breckinridge, and sails to Cuba. Judah P. Benjamin goes to the West Coast and sails to Cuba. He is captured just north of, Jefferson Davis is captured just north of the Florida border.
So we're past the Civil War. Florida is still being largely ignored. Is it being looked upon as really an agricultural state at that time, post-1865?
Yeah, agricultural and port. I mean, it was a real backwater, the population was very, very small, and people only started discovering it, well into the late 19th century.
There are communities that are white only. Georgia has mm-hmm. them, Alabama has them, and I understand Florida. I learned recently about a book about some horrific mm-hmm. things that happened to people, blacks accused of kissing or otherwise assaulting a white girl mm-hmm. are put to death. This is pre-Klan, I understand, where entire communities would come upon people. The Klan makes its run in the early part of the century. You have written a book on the positive side about how presidents have made Florida such a popular place for them to vacation. Who's the first president who comes to Florida?
The well-known Chester A. Arthur.
21st president of the United States?
Wow, you're good. I'm impressed. Chester A. Arthur comes here. What amazes me about Chester A. Arthur is that he wants to go fishing, and nobody in his party want to go fishing. They all want to do something that they have been introduced to once they got here. They want to go to Lake Toho in what's now Osceola County and shoot alligators, which is a huge thing. And he's the only one who wants to go fishing. And so he goes off by himself and he finds this little creek and he catches all kinds of fish. And he says, this is the greatest fishing in the world. This is the greatest place in the world. He said, I wish I could live here in this place. What is amazing is that 80 years later, Walt Disney goes to the same spot, Reedy Creek, and builds Disney World right at Reedy Creek, the same place he was fishing. By the way, Chester A. Arthur could not go south of Kissimmee in 1883.
Really?
He was not allowed to go south of Kissimmee.
Why is that?
There was no telegraph line south of there, and the president could not be out of touch with Washington. So as late as 1883, there's no telegraph from Kissimmee south. So it was that isolated, if you can imagine that. I mean, Oregon, Wyoming, all these places had the telegraph, and South Florida didn't. In fact, you've heard the term the last frontier, which is established by population, number of people per square mile. And when you think of the frontier, you think of Wyoming. Southwest Florida was the last frontier, had the last cattle drives, had the last gunfights. It was that remote of a state.
Now, you have President Cleveland twice, Harrison, Cleveland, McKinley. That's getting us close to 1900. Mm-hmm. Are any of them visiting Florida, establishing summer or winter residence, anything like that happening?
No, McKinley comes here, and it snowed when McKinley came here. He was obviously in Tallahassee.
He's a guy from Canton, Ohio, and he comes to Florida.
Yeah, so we wanted to make him feel at home. The first presidents who come here really begin to come in the 1920s, just like everybody else in the country. Mm-hmm. Is coming here, just, you know, tens of thousands of people flooding into the state for the land boom. Georgia, anybody from Georgia? Ah,
here we go.
Georgia, the largest number of people coming into Florida in the 1920s were from Georgia, and the governor of Georgia was asked if he was concerned about so many people leaving Georgia for Florida, and he said no. It would improve the IQ of both states.
All right, so where is Daytona Beach in the run-up to 1900?
Well, in the going 1920s, Warren G. Harding was here. The first president to visit here, Warren G. Harding. He had his father-in-law, who hated him, detested him.
Probably had a good reason.
Well,
he's womanizing.
His father-in-law was not a reasonable guy. Anyway, he hated Harding, but kind of after he became president, kind of grudgingly accepted things. So his father-in-law had the house in Daytona, and occasionally Warren G. would come by. But after the father-in-law died, came here more often, and his Warren Harding was here a couple of times during his term in a houseboat on the Halifax.
Okay, I want to back up and ask, when is Daytona Beach founded?
In 1876, Matthias Day, who is a really interesting guy. He's from the Midwest. He was a former editor, teacher, abolitionist, inventor, agricultural machinery salesman, and C.M. Hawks sells him on this area. And he comes here and he falls in love with the place. And he has big plans. He's going to build this big city, lays it out, starts recruiting people back in Ohio, and then runs into financial problems almost immediately. And the lots that he's going to sell go into foreclosure within about 2 years of him buying it. But he builds the town, and they lays out the town, recruits people to come here, and it's all working without him. And they name the city after him.
All right, for the benefit of visitors, as well as students, and maybe some folks who are new to our community, I heard that at one point, a part of it was called Seabreeze. Is that correct?
Yeah, what happened was we were three towns. We were, the part that Matthias Day founded was like around downtown, and that was Daytona. Across, where Seabreeze Boulevard is now is the town of Seabreeze. And then south of there was a town that was known variously as Goodall and Daytona Beach. So in 1920s, the three towns merged, the triple cities, although even calling them cities at that point is a little bit of puffery. They're really small places. The triple cities merge and become Daytona Beach.
The city limits Nova Road, or is it like closer to the river?
It's not far, much beyond Ridgewood.
Wow. Yeah,
and gradually creeps up. Nova Road was actually originally built as kind of a bypass so you could drive around the city without going into it. And was named after Project Nova, a heavy lift launch vehicle that was never built. But it was a nice name.
Okay. Ormond Beach and South Daytona, is South Daytona like uncharted territory? Is there anything around Daytona, like an Ormond Beach or a Port Orange?
Oh, yeah. Ormond is founded very quickly after Daytona. And in fact, Matthias Day's son
has a part in founding the founding of Ormond, which was called New Britain for a while, and it was founded like it was found. A lot of people, New Englanders, came. The Corbin Lock Company set up like a retirement community here for their workers, so there were a lot of New Englanders. Which meant that in the 1870s, we had like this little enclave of Republicans in a very democratic state, and in Ormond. Daytona too was really mixed. It wasn't. There were a lot of Midwesterners, a lot of New Englanders, you look at the founding convention where they named the town, and there's. Like 30 people, and they're from all over the place. There are Union veterans, there are Confederate veterans, and there's two black people who voted. It's a really mixed bag.
Mary McLeod Bethune is here. She is close to the Roosevelts. Mm-hmm. How is it that she is in Daytona Beach?
She came here by kind of a fluke, and had the vision for the school, which originally was like a black girls' academy, it's founded in this little. She rents this wooden house that's near a dump, and they go into the dump for school supplies, you know. She realized that a lot of very rich people were wintering here, and. Systematically connected with them, and built up the school from their interest and their funding.
There's a lot of history, both of the state and in Daytona Beach, and in Mark's book, which is Legendary Locals. In it, there I went right to the page. We just lost one of our real champions of public service, civil rights, Jimmy Huger, who is on page 95 of this book. Interesting story that I only found out when he was near death. Was that he wanted to be an actor?
Yeah, he loved that. Acting and music, and he drops out and gets what is considered kind of a good job. He's like a bellhop at a hotel, and one day a Mrs. Bethune shows up, and tells him, doesn't ask him, he just tells him that she arranged for his replacement at the hotel. And not to worry about anything. He was coming back to high school, and she had already worked it out with his employers that he had quit. And get yourself back in the classroom.
Wow.
Fascinating story about Jimmy. We have mayors, and we have a lot of famous people who have spent time here. Mm-hmm. When does Daytona Beach become a vacation place? Well, we know the world's famous beach, mm-hmm. most famous beach, and driving on the beach come in the 50s. But in the 1910 to 1920 period, when America is in this feel-good era before World mm-hmm. War I, people often go to the Jersey Shore. In 1914, there's a major shark attack mm-hmm. that happens there. It makes people say, well, maybe somewhere else. Mm-hmm. Do they start coming to Daytona Beach before or after that?
They start coming here as soon as Flagler puts down the railroad track to get them there. Once you can get from St. Augustine to Ormond Beach, and then later to Daytona, people start coming here. And the Ormond Hotel, which was part of the Flagler chain, is very upscale. I mean, this is like you hear about like people going to Costa Rica for ecotourism tours, and it was kind of like that, you know? This was an exotic place. You could only get there by train or by schooner. And people would come here, play golf, do the jungle cruise, walk around, be guided around the swamp. It was exotic, wild place.
Okay, and we'll come back to some of these things, and we'll take your questions coming up in the next few minutes. Gentlemen, let me take you to World War II. Mm-hmm. Florida and Daytona Beach, we'll take them separately first. How is the state looked upon? Is it as a possible place for the enemy to cross the Atlantic and invade? Are there worries about it? Are there blackouts? How is Florida perched for World War II, Dr. Clark?
Well, I think that two things happen. One, outside of Pearl Harbor, the war comes to Florida first. The first blackouts are in Florida, here in Daytona Beach. What happens is you have Navy bases in Key West and Jacksonville. And so the cities along the coast are illuminated. Oil tankers, there's no pipeline at the time, oil tankers leave Texas, come around Miami, and sail up the coast to the refineries. German submarines are off the coast and just waiting for these oil tankers to come by, and they shoot them. The second thing is that Roosevelt, his first order of World War II is to build 57 PT boats to fight the German submarines off the coast of Florida. But Mark can probably tell you more stories than I can, but this really was kind of a war zone. Ships would be blown up in the middle of the night, and in Daytona and Vero and the cities along there, you know, you might hear a big siren at 3 a.m. and throw on some clothes and go down to the beach. And, you know, just like you see people wiping oil off little animals after oil spills, the wounded and the dying and the dead would wash up on the shore here, and along with the oil. And so people would go down to the shore and nurse them. One sailor said that he had horrible burns on his arm. He was in the worst pain of his life. And he opened his eyes, and there were oil everywhere. And he was moaning. And this lady was kneeling down, and she put his head in her lap. And he just looked horrible. And he was moaning and in pain. And she didn't know what to say. And so finally she said, "So is this your first trip to Florida?" And the man said he was in the worst pain of his life, but he started laughing. But Mark probably knows more about that than I do.
Was the city on high alert?
Well, the city was also a real military. There was a military hospital here around Halifax Hospital, Welsh Convalescent Center. We had Daytona Boat Works, which was building sub chasers and building them at a ferocious rate. In fact, because we didn't have any racing during the war, Bill France worked for Daytona Boat Works as a foreman there during the war years. Suddenly we went from being in the depths of the Depression to being a real center of war industries and hiring like crazy. We had the WACS here, the Women Army Corps. We're training at Bethune Point, had an encampment and had a dormitory over near where the community college is now. And the airport was requisitioned to be a naval training base. So lots of activity here. And Mrs. Bethune, because of her connection with the Roosevelt administration, also was a lobbyist for this area, bringing in war industry and expanding the Bethune-Cookman College to include bringing in black people into the workforce for war industry.
Does Eleanor Roosevelt ever come to Daytona Beach to
Twice.
See? She does.
Yeah, yeah.
Wow. Dr. Clark.
I was going to say, there's a connection here, of course, to Embry-Riddle and World War II. In a way, the war comes to Florida before Pearl Harbor. Britain needed to train pilots, and of course, Britain was the worst place in the world to train pilots early on because Germany controlled the skies. You couldn't have some novice pilot learning how to fly, and so they... the U.S. government agreed that they could train in Arcadia, and they didn't want them trained by the United States government, and so they kind of set up this deal with Embry-Riddle to train pilots, including British pilots, down in Arcadia, and it's a kind of a neat story, I think. That even today, once a year on the British Memorial Day, the British government provides flags to put on the graves of British pilots who died during training. There's a section of the cemetery in Arcadia that's reserved for those British pilots who died in Arcadia training.
So the end of World War II, how long is it before Raytheon comes here and becomes a major employer?
Raytheon I don't know about, but what happens after the war, everyone was worried that, you know, we were in deep depression before the war, and then after the war, no one needs sub chasers anymore, that we're going to fall into another depression immediately. And it doesn't happen in for a number of reasons, and one of them is that a lot of the war stuff, that land that had been requisitioned for the war effort, is immediately transferred to civilian use. The airport turns over within a year, and Eastern Airlines is flying. We have like our first commercial airline service into town, and this is big. Wax, who had trained here, and men who had been at Welsh convalescent home, are coming back here because they remember this place fondly, and are moving here, are visiting here. And the area around Welsh that was that used to be a convalescent center is being turned into a school, which eventually evolves into Daytona Community College.
In 1965, Embry-Riddle moves from South Florida here. Mm-hmm. A pretty big deal with a huge caravan. We celebrated it at the university. And so the community is moving. A speedway is built in 1959?
57, 58, I think it opens in...
After racing on the 59. Beach?
Yeah, the racing on the beach had become untenable because it got so popular that people were crowding in and you couldn't control the crowds. Their famous story that they used to have signs that say, beware rattlesnakes. Not because there were really rattlesnakes in the dunes, but to keep people from sneaking on the dunes and seeing the race for free.
Mark.
Was that a commercial venture, in other words?
Oh yeah.
And that was the charging? Problem.
Oh, absolutely.
Mark uses the term control the crowds. The other term would be get the crowds to pay, which was the problem Bill France faced. Holding them outside on the beach.
And as the cars get heavier and faster, the racetrack on the beach is just becoming a mess. Cars are getting stuck even when they add marl to the sand. It's just a bad surface. Peninsula residents are complaining, and Bill France has this vision, and again, you have all this land that had been military land that got deeded to the county and the city, and that the city now works with France to turn this into the International Speedway.
Okay. I don't think a lot of people realize that driving on the beach goes back more than 100 years in Florida, and starts really in Ormond Beach, which you talked about a minute ago.
The speed trials, which are like 1906.
Six.
I hesitate because like there was this big controversy whether it was 1905, 1906, and I don't want to go there. It's in the 1900s, and these are like really light. These are really light little cars. But what happens is you have rich people at the Ormond Hotel, and when two rich people both have cars, eventually someone wants to know which one is faster.
This is during the era of the Stanley Steamer and all of that.
Believe it or not, the Stanley Steamer from Ormond to Daytona on the beach gets up to 127 miles an hour for a steam-powered car.
Amazing, an amazing vehicle. And so the speed trials go on for a while, but again, they run into a period of sand softness. And they migrate steadily south where the sand's a little harder and there's less of the red sand. And eventually it dies out. And this is brought back in the 1930s during kind of the golden age of speed trials in Daytona, where you have, this is where the slogan, the world's most famous beach, comes from, is when we've got worldwide attention and we're all on all the newsreels about the amazing speed trials here.
All right, settle this for us, because there's been a rumor for a long time. And not to take you off topic, but the beach used to be bigger and wider, and now it's smaller. Is it?
Yeah. And, you know, beach width is like also a very cyclical thing. It builds, it disperses. But right now, there is a measurable problem with sea level rise that we're seeing, and A1A is falling into the ocean again.
The beach was also largely deserted back then. That's why Flagler's early hotels were built on landside. You didn't want to go to the beach. A suntan was not viewed as a good thing in 1900. In fact, for men, it meant you were a laborer. You worked outside. So the beaches were largely empty, which is why the cars went there. The other reason they chose Ormond was, you mentioned the rich people there. A lot of these early car makers like Ransom Olds and even Henry Ford came down not only to test their cars, but to hope that some rich person like John D. Rockefeller, who had built a home there, would see them and want to invest. So it was a giant kind of show and tell. Let me show you how fast my car can go, and would you like to invest in it? So it served a lot of purposes and really one of the birthplaces of the automobile industry.
Okay, we're going to talk about the space program in a moment. We are going to take your questions, but first, two major things happen. The building of the Speedway, of course, and Disney. There was a story when I first went on the air here 25 years ago, and you probably had a chance to write about it several times, Mark, where they said, well, you know, Bob Hope was going to do some big development here, and they ran him off. And then Walt Disney was going to develop in Daytona Beach and put his theme park, but we ran him off because our zoning was too difficult. Is there any truth to the fact that Walt ever looked here?
No, in fact, I've heard this since I was a kid, and I, you know, went back to the original announcement about Disney World. Walt Disney had this press conference in Orlando and announced the site and what his vision was. And News Journal had a reporter there, and who asked, you know, were you looking at sites, scouting sites in Volusia County? And he said, "Where's Volusia County?" Wow. He had no idea.
You know, I think he was being disingenuous. The Disney family lived in Paisley. I don't know if any of you know where Paisley is. It's over in northern Lake County, straight from here. And in fact, this is amazing to me. First of all this area belonged to Mosquito County. And Volusia County broke off, Brevard County broke off. Seminole County was the last to break off. The next to the last was Lake County. Lake County became a county in 1887, okay? And it was so small and had so few people, it was 9 months before anybody applied for a marriage license, okay? Wait a minute, here's the kicker. The couple that applied for the marriage license were Walt Disney's parents. Walt Disney's father operated a hotel in Halifax and went bankrupt. They seem to be doing better in the hotel business now. But the family had all kinds of setbacks and left. Walt came here as a child. And of course, there was no US-1, there was no 95. And the only road out of Paisley went east and west, either to Volusia County or over to Ocala. And so he was very familiar with both places, and he considered Ocala. In fact, he went to Ocala the day before he went to Orlando, scoped out Ocala as a possible site because he knew it. He knew Ocala. He'd gone there as a child. He also considered Volusia County without looking at it because he knew it, but rejected both Volusia County and the Sarasota area, because as he said, he didn't want to compete with a free attraction, the beach.
Wow.
He didn't want people saying, gee, should we spend $100 to go to Disney World or go to the beach for free? And so they were rejected. He went to, that's strange he would say that, but because he went there as a child. And
maybe it's his way of slapping at us.
Yeah, maybe so. The strange story is a lot of you in this room can tell me where you were when Walt Disney picked Orlando for Walt Disney World.
What year was that?
Wait a minute, let me tell and we'll see how many can figure it out.
Wow. Were you, anybody hear the announcement? Do you remember where you were? Lady up that way.
Watch this. We'll see how many people in 1 minute. Ready?
Yeah.
He flies into Tampa and then drives up to Ocala and spends the day there looking at property, comes back to Tampa. He has to get back to California for his TV show. So the next day, he flies over Orlando. And about 1 o'clock in the afternoon, he points to a piece of land where the turnpike and I-4 cross, and he says, that's it. Mm-hmm. The plane banks and heads back to California. He stops in New Orleans and gets off the plane. They have to refuel. And one of the ground crew came up to him and said, Mr. Disney, did you hear that John Kennedy was just shot and killed in Dallas? So what's really weird is that we all remember the Kennedy assassination, and yet it was Walt Disney that changed Florida that day and had probably a more impact on our lives.
And the anniversary tomorrow.
Yes, the anniversary of Walt Disney picking Orlando as the site.
Oh, wow. That's amazing. That just stops you right there. Okay, so we have that going on, and then we have the issue of space flight. It's the 50s. The Russians get out first. There's a competition, though, gentlemen, between Texas and Florida as to where this is going to be. Atmospheric conditions bear into it. I'm certainly the least qualified here to speak of it.
No, I'm the least qualified.
And we have scientists that are sitting with us.
Yeah. Okay,
so tell us, how do they divvy up the program that Florida gets a piece of it and Texas gets a piece?
I'll tell the first part. Actually, it starts in New Mexico, White Sands, and this is your government at work. They start firing the missiles, and as you know, in the early days, they crashed more than they went up. And so the space people start talking about, well, if it really went off course, it would hit California. And governor of California says, wait a minute, you can't have a missile hitting my state. And so in great bureaucratic fashion, they said, okay, we'll change things around and we'll make it so they won't hit California. And they held a news conference to announce that. And they said that from now on, any errant missiles would land in Mexico. And immediately, of course, the Mexican government said, wait a minute, you can't send your missiles here. And so really, Titusville was the third choice for the space program to begin launching missiles back in the 1940s.
Mark, did they think it'd be a bonanza too?
Yeah. Oh, here, everyone thought that we'd get, actually here locally, we thought we'd get a bigger piece of it than we really did. Yeah. Florida was always in the running at some point because we're on the coast, there's this ocean for things to fall in. In fact, as early, you go back to the 19th century and Jules Verne, From the Earth to the Moon, this is, they launched the capsule from Florida, you know, in 19th century science fiction. So it does just make sense. I personally feel part of this because that's how I came here. My dad worked for General Electric, which did Gemini and Apollo launch systems.
When does GE come here?
1962.
Okay.
That's when I was driven there in the back of a Rambler station wagon. So that I remember that very well. And so like people are asking my dad, it's October 1962 and you're going to Florida. Why?
During the missile crisis.
During the height of the missile crisis.
Okay. And I want to stop for this because before we get to more of what GE then became, Larry Kelly comes in 63 with a boatload of other people, and they all settle and GE grows. What was it like in Florida and in Daytona Beach during the missile crisis? Mind you, we did a special on it here as part of the Embry-Riddle series with John Johnson, and we brought a historian in with him. Was everybody thinking that we're going to die or be radiated or we were going to war? What were the feelings, state and local?
People were freaked out. And again, I was only in kindergarten at the time. But I did know that, like, you know, we had a drill at school. A bell would go off, and we'd go in the cafeteria and cower under the tables. Now, how this helped you in the case of a nuclear attack. Later on, I thought, this sounds ineffectual. But this is what we did. And, you know, as a little kid, you just accept this, and it's really kind of terrifying. Well, why are we all trooping into the cafeteria and going under the tables? Well, in case bombs fall. And it colors your perceptions, I think.
What about the rest of the state?
Well, there was military alerts. This was kind of a mini economic boom for the air base in Orlando reopened. They used that as the training center. People forget there was one casualty in the missile crisis. A pilot was shot down, and he was flying from Orlando.
The U-2?
A spy plane, and he was shot down and killed. Flying from Orlando down to Cuba.
I kept wondering if the people in Key West and Miami, Fort Lauderdale, did they feel like one big scram, you know, like we ought to get out of here? Did people leave even temporarily for the fear that
the Cubans, Keys especially.
From the Keys. And what's funny is, like, there were a bunch of bomb shelters built around, and like the Streamline Hotel advertised itself as not having only having excellent accommodations and a bar on the roof, but a bunker
shelter
in the basement. And in Port Orange, there was somebody had just built by themselves a bomb shelter, and then after nothing happened, it was later turned into a tourist attraction. It was like this snaking bomb shelter, and was made the fabulous atomic tunnel roadside attraction on US 1.
Some of the folks in the audience who may not have been here, it was before I came here, Fort Lauderdale's mayor decided that where the boys are in beach and spring break, enough is enough, and said, okay, here's a box of Scram, leave. A bunch of people from here, Mark, went on Good Morning America. I think Larry Kelly may have been one of them, maybe Bud Asher.
Bud Asher.
Said, oh, they don't want you, come here. And we became spring break land, right?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah, we kind of had successive waves of spring break there. 1966 spring break, Easter break was like a really big thing. And in fact, you could drink on the beach until 1966. And after that spring break, they banned alcohol on the beach.
Very effectively, yeah. Oh my God. Yeah.
Yeah, you got to have a koozie from then on. And then the really big spring break, though, happened in the when MTV came here in the 80s, and that's when we were the world capital of spring break.
And what the fight here in this community was, the hoteliers thought it was great because they could do well, but I remember when I first came here, 60 minutes or 48 hours came out, I think, in 1991, because it was in 1989. That's when we had all the balcony falls, and wasn't that where the crisis really happened, and they decided maybe we don't want spring break in 89?
89 was just bad craziness here, and the whole peninsula was gridlocked. And that was kind of it. Several hotels got closed down because they were so trashed by the students. Everything was party out of bounds, and so when came time for spring break, for MTV to say, how much will you pay us to be here next year, the answer was probably nothing.
And so they left here and they started going west, I guess. They went to Texas,
California,
California, west, went west in Florida, Texas, And then some went to Europe, spring break.
And islands, and this is another thing, the spring break market after MTV left Daytona splintered, and it was in a whole bunch of places, and even on MTV, you would see them going to Galveston, Mexico, Cozumel, different places on the same show, and the market fragmented, and so nobody was the capital of spring break anymore.
Dr. Clark, they also went to Panama City, and for a while they all kind of stayed there, and then they got tired and they threw them out, right?
Yeah, I think it's an economic thing that as, for example, Panama City, they started going there, people started building condos, and the land values went up. And once you had all those condos and once you had an influx of middle class, upper middle class, and wealthy people, they didn't want the kids anymore. Mm-hmm. Same with Fort Lauderdale, same with here, that early on, hey, that money looked good, but now people cared more about their property values and their safety and things like that.
This is an educational tool, this program as well, so we hope people will come back and listen and watch. A state that brought you Walken Lawton, but before that, I think you told me a couple of years ago when we talked that Harry S. Truman developed the first winter home here or something, am I right?
Yeah, presidents in winter love Florida. You know, it's gonna be interesting with President Trump because we really haven't had a president come and stay here in a long time. They, as you know, they fly in for a fundraiser and are here for about 3 hours, tie up traffic and leave. But we have presidents. John Kennedy had the home in Palm Beach. Harry Truman was very poor. Harry Truman had no money at all. And so today the Obamas, for example, would rent a big house in Massachusetts on, you know, Martha's Vineyard, but he couldn't afford anything like that. And somebody told him, hey, if you go to a Navy base, the Navy will pay for your vacation. Mm-hmm. They'll transport you there. And so he went to the Navy base in Key West. The other one, of course, was Richard Nixon. Quick story, his best friend was George Smathers, senator from Florida. And when Nixon was elected, there was a rumor that he was gonna name a Democrat to his cabinet, and then a rumor that George Smathers would be chosen attorney general. And sure enough, the phone call came from Nixon's office, said, hey, the president-elect would like to call you tomorrow morning at 10 o'clock. And Smathers said, great. And so he got his whole family there, and sure enough, 10 o'clock, Nixon called, and Nixon said, George, I want to ask you a favor. He said, I know you are going to go looking forward to retirement at your home in Florida, but I need to ask you something. And Smathers said, Mr. President, anything you want, you can have. And Nixon said, well, let me tell you what, no, you can have it. Whatever it is, you can have it. And Nixon said, but I think I ought to tell you, no, you don't even have to say it. Just tell me what you want and you can have it. And Nixon said, well, great. He said, will you sell me your house in Key Biscayne? And that became the Nixon Key Biscayne winter Florida White House. So presidents and Nixon would come down here a lot. It's gonna be interesting to see if President Trump becomes a regular in Palm Beach.
Yeah,
and stays.
The word, I think he's gonna spend time down here.
Yeah.
The story came out in the last couple of days, so good for us, I guess.
Yeah, and I guess Harding, Harding is famous. You mentioned the Harding story. You mentioned Harding's houseboat.
Yeah.
My favorite, two favorite Harding stories are he gets stuck in the Indian River on a sandbar on the houseboat. And, you know, can you imagine if that happened today? You'd have the Air Force called out, you'd have everybody, the Navy, but nothing happened. And the guy who he was sailing with said, we'll have to wait till tomorrow when the tide comes back in. And so Harding gets in a little dinghy and rows ashore and hires a car to take him around just to see the area. When he gets back to the dock, there's a man standing there, and he says, oh, welcome to Titusville. He said, I want to give you this deed to a lot in Cocoa Beach. And Harding says, well, I can't take that. And the man kept insisting and kept insisting. And finally, Harding says, okay, and he puts it in his pocket. The next day, the tide comes in, lifts the boat off. By that time, there are signs along the coast saying, be President Harding's neighbor, buy a lot in Cocoa Beach. And the other one, has anybody been to Sarasota to Harding Circle?
No.
No? Nobody's been to Longboat Key?
Yes.
To Harding Circle?
I never even put the
it
two together.
It has great shopping?
Oh.
You've never been to Harding Circle?
We've had sheltered lives here in Daytona.
I can't believe that. Nobody's been to that beautiful circle right on Longboat Key?
You're in Daytona where the fun never stops.
No.
There's never any reason to leave here.
Haven't y'all been to Sarasota? Anyway,
tell us what we've missed.
The promoters want to come up with a way to sell lots on Longboat Key, so they convince Harding that they're going to build a permanent winter White House on Longboat Key, and he'll be able to use it. Harding likes the idea, and so they begin laying out their city, their presidential city, and they build Harding Circle, and then they begin naming the roads, starting with Washington Street, Adams, Jefferson. Mm. I think they get up to about Jackson Street, and then Harding dies.
Goes to California, gets on a train, and dies.
Yeah, and so they've lost their reason. They've lost their hook for selling lots, and so they give up. So I think it stops with maybe Jackson or somebody like that. And then as Harding becomes more and more disreputable, they have this circle named Harding Circle, and so they rename it St. Armand's Circle.
Wow. I got to make sure I get this in. Both books have interesting covers to them. On Mark Lane's book, I recognize at least two of the people. One of them is Yvonne Scarlett Golden, who was the mayor of this city.
Mm-hmm.
Was she the first African-American mayor?
Yeah, she was the first African-American mayor. Not the first African-American to serve, because, of course, Jimmy Huger, and in the 19th century, we had another, the city of Daytona had a black council member in, it's like the 1890s, I think. And so, but she was the first black mayor and the first black woman mayor, and died before she finished her second term.
Incredible pictures in this book. Annie Oakley was here?
Annie Oakley was here by mistake. She was driving to a to one of her shows in Flagler down Dixie Highway, and got hit and got in a terrible car accident, and the nearest hospital was in Daytona. And she had like a really serious leg injury and was here for like a year. And the local post office was strained with the job of bringing get well cards from across the nation to her. But after about a year, she got better and had to wear a leg brace for a while, but could still stand on one leg and shoot a penny in the air, you know?
How many people remember that Bryan Cranston, the actor, actually, what, you got his start here?
He was at the Little Theater. He was. His parents owned a hotel on A1A, and he went to Seabreeze for a while, and he played in musicals at Seaside Music Theater and at the Little Theater, and just loved it. And so he got on a motorcycle with his girlfriend and drove out to California to become famous. And we've all heard stories that begin that way, but he actually got famous.
Now, on James Clark, Dr. Clark's book on hidden history of Florida, there is a mermaid on the front.
Yes.
What's the story of this picture?
Wiki-Watchee. Many of you probably remember Wiki-Watchee. One of the early attractions in Florida, where a former Navy scuba expert from World War II devised a way for air hoses for them to in effect breathe underwater. And so after World War II, he started this this attraction over on the West Coast, and highly successful.
Did I get this right? Pocahontas is linked with the first barbecue? I'm looking at this. It says, and true, and darker side of Pocahontas is linked with the first barbecue. It's on the back cover of the book.
Yeah, you know, I told you earlier, Texas stole our flag. Georgia and Alabama and Mississippi and Louisiana stole about half of our state. And South Carolina even. Parris Island was originally part of Florida in South Carolina. But people also sold our stories. And in 1521, a Spanish soldier is captured. And the chief wants to put him to death. And puts him over a fire, and begins to burn him. And the chief's daughter has fallen in love with him, and he says, "Oh, father, please, please spare him, for I love him." And so they spare him, and he picks up from his experience over the fire. He picks up the Tamunquan word for burned at the stake, which is barbecue. Next time you hold a barbecue, think of Juan Ortiz basting over the open flame. A century later, by the way, Ortiz writes his memoirs after he gets back to Spain, and a century later, John Smith writes his memoirs. Nobody had ever mentioned Pocahontas or anything like that, and all of a sudden he steals Juan Ortiz's Pocahontas story, which had happened a century earlier. So that's where the word barbecue comes from.
There is a photograph of what appears to be John F. Kennedy in an open-top car. I'm not sure who the other people are.
George Smathers. It was taken the weekend before Kennedy was killed. Smathers was an amazing man. He served three terms as a United States Senator. And his two best friends in Washington were John Kennedy and Richard Nixon, who seemed to me to be polar opposites.
Wow.
But he was in Kennedy's wedding. In fact, I did about a six-hour oral history with George Smathers. And he kept talking about how he and Kennedy used to double date. And finally, I had to stop him and I said, "Senator, when you're married, do they still call it double dating?" Because he and Kennedy would go out on the prowl after they were married, and you've heard that. By the way, be careful of your friends. It's Smathers who's responsible for most of the Kennedy sex stories. Hey, I remember the time Jack and I did this, you know. So, Kennedy came here the weekend before he was killed in Dallas. He went to his Palm Beach house. They had he's shaking hands with the crowd in South Florida. Then he came up and gave a speech to a union group in Tampa. And then he comes over to Titusville to inspect the progress on the moon launch, which is, 6 years away at the time, and then flies back to Washington. And then the next Friday, he is killed in Dallas. Mm-hmm.
We have a time to take a few questions. If you have a question for either Dr. Clark or for Mark, if you would come right up and ask your question so we can have you on the record, it would be great. And then our partners from the bookstore here at Embry-Riddle will be selling copies of the book. Dr. Clark and Mark Lane will be signing them right here. Your first, good evening, sir. Thank you for being here.
And tell me how they impacted Daytona, if they did. Al Capone, Lindbergh, and the Wright brothers.
Starting with the Wright brothers, you know, one of the Daytona's aviation history is really kind of fascinating. And Law. One of the very first women to fly, Ruth Law, used to give lessons on a Wright plane over at the hotel at the end of Seabreeze, the Clarendon then, and she'd take you up. She'd take you up in the biplane, and she did this for a couple of years and was actually learned to fly from one of the Wright brothers, who was kind of dubious about women doing this, but a client's a client. And so she operated here for a number of years. There's a, well, this is a too long and involved a story, but yeah, she one time there she had dropped a she was hired to drop a baseball from the air, and they couldn't find a baseball, and so she dropped a grapefruit from the air. Brooklyn Dodgers were training here at the time, and so she dropped the grapefruit, which hit the catcher on the chest, and he thought he had been killed. And he saw this pink stuff on him. she was up for stunts like that and did that. The other two names were Al Capone and what was the other?
Lindbergh.
Lindbergh was in Flagler. He had an incident in Flagler, and I'm unclear about the details. In fact, that was like in my notes to do something about, because the anniversary, that was in November of 1926, or so. Like there's an anniversary coming up on that.
Was Capone here?
Capone was here, but his. He would kind of pass through and visit. He was not. People think that like he had a place here and all that, but he was. People drove through here down Dixie Highway on their way south a lot, and he was kind of a guy who stopped over rather than had a real operation here. And you'd be surprised at the people who passed through town.
Batista had a home here, though.
Oh, Batista right, had a Cuba. Home, the where the Greek Orthodox Church collection. Is now, and the art collection. Batista thought that he was going to spend exile here, but the American government wasn't quite into that. And another person who passed, Ernest Hemingway used to stop here on his way to Key West to have a drink. And the old Silver Bucket Bar on Seabreeze used to have a picture of him behind the cash register, autographed picture of Hemingway from the days when he'd stop here.
Capone has the house, obviously, in Miami. There are several islands between Miami and Miami Beach, and his is on one of those, I think Palm Island. Herbert Hoover goes down there after being elected president in 1928 and stays on a nearby island with his good friend J.C. Penney. And two things happen. One, Hoover goes to a hotel for a meeting, and the reporters all crowd around him, just like they're doing mm-hmm. with President-elect Trump today. Who are you going to name to your cabinet? Mm. What are you going to do? And then all of a sudden the reporters start drifting away, and pretty soon there's nobody there. And Hoover turns to an aide and says, "What happened? Where'd everybody go?" And the aide says, a little sheepishly, "Well, Al Capone just walked into the lobby, and they went to interview him." And then a couple nights later, Hoover is asleep and he hears gunfire, and he gets out of bed and he finds a servant and says, "What is that?" And they say, "Oh, those Capone people are shooting off their guns." And he says, "That's horrible." And Hoover had never had Capone on his radar, but now he begins asking questions. And the first day of his presidency, he calls in the Treasury Secretary and says, "Get Capone." And there's a book out called Get Capone. And that's why he ends up being charged with tax evasion, because he's given the job to the Treasury Secretary. But if it hadn't been for Miami, Capone might have gotten off.
Over here, your question. Good evening, sir.
Are we out of time?
No, go.
Okay. I had a question, not a historical question, more of a question of the future, when you mentioned that President-elect Trump might be coming to West Palm Beach for his winter of stays. I'm a retired airline pilot, and I can remember any time the president came to an airport, the airport was basically shut down. My concern is my son, who is actually a Riddle graduate, who is also flying for United Airlines as I was, commutes from West Palm Beach to Newark. And my concern is that President Trump's going to shut the airport down that he commutes out of. Do you have any idea how that's going to work?
Yeah, and you know, you're absolutely right. And the funny thing is, he has been battling the airport for more than a decade now over the flights. And now, of course, he has the power to shut it down. So he may just call and say he's flying down every day just to close the airport. He hates the Palm Beach airport. I know.
Thank you, sir. Over here, your question. Good evening.
Yes, I'm with the Palm Coast Civil War Roundtable, and I'm interested what you found most interesting about the Florida Civil War period.
Well, I don't have a lot in my book about the Civil War period because this place was so sparsely populated at that time. Really, the only coastal settlement was New Smyrna, where they had a salt works, and of course, the Florida being Florida, some really active smuggling from Bermuda and the Bahamas. There was a small union operation in New Smyrna to kind of shut down the salt works. And that was pretty much our entire Civil War here. People really didn't come here in any numbers on the east coast of Volusia until the 1870s.
Additional?
Yeah, just quick things. One, South Florida, way south towards Miami, was basically uninhabitable or unsafe. It was pirate country, and it was the ultimate lawlessness. You had deserters from both armies heading that way because they knew that nobody would ever find them there, kind of hiding with the old Seminoles down there. Secondly, the Herald Tribune, New York Herald Tribune, called Florida the smallest tadpole in the cesspool of secession, because it was such a tiny state, and yet we sent, per capita, we sent more soldiers to the Confederacy, 15,000, than any other state. And think about that, our population was only about 100,000. And so Florida was a disaster. Think about it, that 7% of our population was either killed or lost a limb in the Civil War. So Florida, again, not very important militarily, only the one real battle, but people here paid a horrible price.
We can take a couple more questions while I wait for anyone else to come up that would like to ask a question of our two guests. We would be remiss if we didn't mention that baseball's color barrier was broken here. Jackie Robinson playing a short distance away at
Jackie Robinson Ballpark. Then it was City Island Ballpark, and we had the anniversary just last year. And this was an amazing thing because surrounding towns couldn't get that game played. You know, Robinson was thrown out of Sanford. And then DeLand announced they couldn't play the game during the daytime because the lights weren't working. And Jacksonville was a problem, and so here it was played, and people at the time said that part of it was that Daytona, because had a less hostile racial climate than other places, and also the city administration was cool with it, and they promised that they'd play, the team would come back for spring training, which they did. They only did spring training for a year or two here, and then moved to Cuba, where Robinson could play without hassle. And that was our moment. That was a big deal for us.
I think that people don't give Robinson and the Dodgers enough credit for integration in Florida. It's hard today to understand how big spring baseball was back then. It was like an attraction. Mm-hmm. Hundreds of thousands of people came down every year, and many stayed for all of spring training. Robinson, 47, I guess, mm-hmm. 1947, is from California. He's drafted. He flies here, and the plane, and he's never experienced Jim Crow laws. He stops in Pensacola, and now for the first time experiences the Deep South. He gets off the plane. He and his wife say, let's go get a cup of coffee. They try to go into the coffee shop, and the waitress says, what are you doing in here? And throws them out. Then it's just a short stopover. They go to board the plane, and the Delta agent says, I'm sorry, the plane is overloaded. You can't get back on. And then the next flight comes in, and they're told it's overbooked. Finally, they call Daytona, and they say, hey, they keep telling us there are no flights. And of course, people in Daytona know what's happening. And so they have to take a 15-hour bus ride from Pensacola to Daytona. What Robinson and the Dodgers do, though, basically, to change the way Florida thinks is to go to Major League Baseball and say, hey, there are these people out in Arizona who want us to come and practice out there. Do you want us to move spring training out there? And all of a sudden, the attitude begins to change throughout the South. In towns like Sanford, Major League Baseball is the economic force that drives it. By the way, they stop the game. They play the game for about two innings in mm-hmm. Sanford. And then Robinson gets a hit and goes to first base. At that point, the police chief comes out and stops the game. Any idea why they waited until that point?
Curfew.
No? Anybody? A white and a black are both touching first base.
Oh, wow.
And so baseball really helps bring about integration, led by, I've forgotten his name, but he was a local Packard automobile dealer here, leads the effort to accommodate African Americans. Otherwise, Daytona and all these cities would have lost Major League Baseball. Yeah. And as it is now, half the teams are in Arizona.
The Lloyds? Could it have been the Lloyds? No?
I don't know. As a Packard dealer.
Okay. Sure, two things you want to get in here, too. There were so many great governors. You'll have to read about them in both of these books. But before we take this gentleman's question, we elected a governor who walked the state. As big as the state was, mm-hmm. Lawton Childs. Gentlemen, give us thoughts on Lawton Childs. It's what made him special was walking Lawton.
Well, that's it. And it was, the whole walking Lawton thing is very legendary. The shoes are in the museum over.
Did he actually do it?
Yeah, he did. Yeah, he did really it did. In sections. He did the the state. He walked through Volusia too. I remember seeing the clippings from the News Journal. He part of his path went down present day ISB, but he went through here.
Question. Well, oh, go ahead, Mark. Go ahead, Dr.
I was just Kuhler. Lawton was a lawyer in Lakeland. Talk about being in the right place at the right time. He owned a piece of land, which was basically worthless, and a new company said they wanted to lease his land. And he said, fine, he'd never heard of these people, but they were going to give him some money. And so they leased his land and asked him if he wanted to buy stock in their company that didn't exist yet. Mm-hmm. And he said, okay. Mm-hmm. And the restaurant was the first Red Lobster built in the United States. And it's still there. If you ever drive to Tampa on I-4, there's a Red Lobster right by the interstate. Mm. That's the very first one ever built.
Your question, sir.
Interesting. So I've seen picture, I think, of a casino down on Beach Street. Was the Halifax River come up close to Beach Street and there was a big casino on it?
Yeah, it was called the casino, but the casinos also at one, the older, older sense of the word was just as kind of an auditorium generally. So it wasn't a gaming casino. Burgoyne Casino existed over on what is now that park that's across from Jackie Robinson Ballpark. Commodore Burgoyne built that, and it was like the center of town.
That's great.
For many years, it burned down in the 30s.
Mm-hmm. Want to thank Bob Davidson and Justin upstairs for running our audio and video. Chivalry Wu, who is capturing our video tonight as well. We thank him for that. Sergio Baca, Deepak Kumar, Juliet Okeke, and Alex Hall, students who helped to seat you all tonight. And Joshua, thank you. Now, want to tell you that this is the final part of our series for the fall. We hope you come back in January when we reopen our series with the Embry-Riddle Eagles. It's a celebration of excellence in all athletics. You'll get to meet stars of the Eagles basketball and all the sports here on January 17th. And then on the 30th, the end of the Apollo program. Why did it end? The final flights written by an expert from the University of Tennessee. She will be here. So, on behalf of all of us here at Embry-Riddle, we wish you the happiest of holiday seasons. Merry Christmas, Happy Thanksgiving, Happy New Year. See you in January. Once again, our guest, Dr. James Clark, Mark Lane. Thank you.